Hello and welcome to Understanding Your Air Permit, plus Required Reporting and Record Keeping. This module is brought to you by the Environmental Compliance Assistance Program, which is part of the Energy and Environment Cabinet. When you receive a permit, be sure to read the entire document. Become familiar with and understand your facility emission units and compliance demonstration methods. We will go over the permit layout with screenshot examples of permit sections from several sources. We will not go into depth about each of the actual conditions, but rather present examples so you may see where and what you are looking at in the different sections of your permit. This is the cover page. On it, you will find the permittee and source name and mailing address, which may be the same as the source location, where the facility resides, which is not a PO box, but rather a physical address. The permit ID, which starts with an F, G, S, or V, depending on the type of permit. The agency interest number, which is a very important identifier when dealing with the Department for Environmental Protection. It is a good number to memorize or at least have handy. The review type. This is the type of source you are, whether that be minor, conditional major, Title V, or more. Source ID. This is a 10-digit number that starts with 21. The regional office and contact information. This is the address you send the annual compliance certifications, ACC, and semi-annual monitoring reports, SAMRs, to. Keep in mind the location could have moved since the permit was issued. The issuance date and expiration date. As a note, all facilities must submit a permit renewal 6 months prior to the expiration date. Be sure to mark this on your calendar. Here is the general permit layout. Many Kentucky Division of Air Quality permits have the same general sections as presented here, and many permits are presented in a similar manner, but some layouts may vary. We will go through each section individually in the upcoming slides. This is Section A. Its look will vary depending on the type of source you are. This Section A was taken from a conditional major permit. Let's dissect some of this language. Paragraph 1 states an application was submitted, and the Division of Air Quality authorizes the operation of equipment in accordance to terms and conditions of the permit. Paragraph 2 states submitting a complete application and receiving a permit is required prior to construction, reconstruction, or modification with any exceptions noted in the permit. Paragraph 3 states obtaining the permit does not relieve the permittee of the responsibility of obtaining other required permits, whether that be federal, state, or local. This is Section B. It labels each emission point or emission unit, provides a description, and may indicate rated capacities, control equipment, and efficiencies. If you have several emission points that are similar, the permit may group the requirements instead of listing them for each point. In Section B, the applicable regulations are referenced for all emission points. The Section B for each emission point is then broken into the 7 parts listed here. The way these are referenced may vary between facilities due to differences among operations and sources. For example, Part 1, the operating limitations. These are 3 examples. The first operating limitation listed provides an actual limitation. The filters are to be in place and operational according to manufacturer's specifications anytime the booth is in use. The second example shows there are no operating limitations associated with the emission point. Finally, the last example refers us to another section of the permit to find the applicable operating limitations. Section 2 under emission limitations is where you will find what the limitation is and how you are to prove the limitation is being maintained. For example, a common limitation is an opacity limit or visible emissions limitation. The method of compliance for this unit is weekly observations and maintaining a log. If you are required to monitor it, then you should always record it and report it. Opacity measurements remain the mainstay of federal, state, and local air pollution control efforts due to interest in fugitive emissions and the evident relationship of opacity to particulate matter 10, PM10, which is coarse particles, and PM2.5, generally described as fine particle emissions. Typical opacity measurements are based on visual observations, a qualitative method to determine if opacity is present or not. However, in certain instances, it may be required to provide a quantitative result, which provides actual data that can be measured and expressed numerically. Here we see an example of a qualitative compliance demonstration method for opacity. In plain speak, this language says that the facility shall perform visual observations and record those observations in a log. EPA Reference Method 9, which is found in 40 CFR Part 60 Appendix A, has been adopted throughout the country as a visible emissions inspection method in an effort to standardize the training and certification of observers and to ensure that reliable and repeatable opacity observations can be conducted anywhere in the United States. Here we can see some of the forms used to record observations made through Method 9. If you do not record it, you did not do it. Accurate record keeping is essential when determining compliance with your permit requirements and maintaining legal defensibility of your data. It is important to use actual product usage and to include all emission sources when demonstrating compliance with air permit requirements. Kentucky determines the type of air permit required for a facility based on the potential to emit, which is the maximum potential an emission source can produce. This determination assumes the source operates 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. This is done to allow greater flexibility for the permit holder to operate. However, any fees associated with the permit are based on the actual usage of the emission source, which is another great reason to keep accurate records. Record keeping is the backbone of permit compliance and must be performed and reported as indicated by the permit. Records must be kept for a period of at least 5 years and must always be available for review. Hazardous air pollutants and volatile organic compound limitations usually require 12-month rolling totals to be kept. Your permit explains how to calculate the rolling total, usually in Section D. An example of a true emission limit is when a limit is imposed for a particular pollutant. This occurs when an air toxics assessment indicates that a particular level of a defined pollutant is determined to be hazardous to human health or the environment when above a certain level. This is an example from another conditional major permit that is required to perform rolling totals of their HAP and VOC emissions. In this case, the air toxics assessment indicates that the facility cannot emit more than 2 tons per year of ethyl benzene. PM10 and PM2.5 particles are particularly dangerous because when inhaled, they can travel deep into the lungs and cause or aggravate existing heart and lung issues. Another common emission limit is for particulate matter. In this case, the filter system is to be maintained and operated in accordance with the manufacturer's specifications. We can also see an example of a log where filter observations are noted as a part of record-keeping requirements. 401 of the Kentucky Administrative Regulations, Chapter 59, Section 10, is a common regulation that covers new process operations. As you can see from the slide, the maximum allowable emission rate of particulate matter for a source is based on the process weight, which can be determined in pound per hour or ton per hour. Section B provides an emission limitation for particulate matter and provides information on how to determine compliance with the limits mentioned on the previous slide. Using this formula, we can take information given in the previous slide and determine if a facility is in compliance for the emission limitation set for PM. Testing requirements. Again, these will vary depending on the operation. Some require frequent testing. Others require testing upon request from the Energy and Environment Cabinet. Monitoring requirements are written into the permit and required so the facility remains aware of the state of the emission unit and observes the operations for any changes that may occur over time. Monitoring requirements ensure that the emissions from the emission unit are supervised, tested, sampled, or otherwise observed on a regular and ongoing basis. Types of monitoring include product usage, visual limitations, and more. This section may fully describe the requirements or reference a different section of the permit that has already listed these requirements, like we saw the opacity limit listed in Section B2. Record keeping requirements. Again, some permits will list or potentially relist all the required records, or will reference another portion of the permit that has already indicated the record-keeping requirement. Records can be kept on paper or electronically. For example, this permit requires opacity logs, paint booth logs, material usage logs, rolling total emission calculations, and apparently, looking at E, the facility also has lower limits on naphthalene and cobalt emissions due to an air toxics assessment. Reporting requirements, the same theory applies. Again, remember, if you are required to monitor, then record and report. Section 7 contains the control equipment requirements. Make sure you keep records of any maintenance, for example, when you change out filters. Section C lists the insignificant activities. Insignificant does not mean they can be forgotten about. You may still have requirements to report on them in your EIS or list them on your semi-annual and annual reports. Just because these are listed as insignificant does not mean ignore them. As you can read in this text, the permittee must comply with the regulations and the opacity standards shall be inspected monthly and recorded in a log. In addition, those that have to keep 12-month rolling totals, such as this facility, where there are VOCs and HAPs, will need to include the solvents used for the gun cleaning listed in this insignificant activity. Section D contains explanations on how to calculate the 12-month rolling totals, or PM emission limitations. This may also be called a general condition section of the permit. It has important information, so be sure to read it. 12-month rolling totals are a common permitting requirement and involve collecting data monthly. Here are examples of some typical emission totals and operations that require a 12-month rolling total. The 12-month rolling sum is simply the total amount from the past 12 months. As the 12-month period rolls forward each month, the amount from the latest month is added and the one-year-old amount is subtracted. The result is a 12-month total that has rolled forward to the new month. Continue to do this each month and check that the total is below permit limits. Your permit will tell you if you need to use the 12-month rolling sum for tracking emissions, production limits, or operational limits. As you can see, this slide goes over the setup table for rolling totals, which includes the products, which emission points they are used in, and monthly usage. This example is for a paint booth and tracks the gallons of product used per month. You may have to complete 12-month rolling sums for multiple pollutants, and you may have multiple sources for each pollutant. Remember, the safety data sheets provide valuable data, such as VOC percentages and the density. Again, we see an example of a 12-month rolling total tracking spreadsheet. The actual usage is recorded and the spreadsheet will update accordingly. For anyone who does not have a current 12-month rolling total spreadsheet available, ECAP can assist in developing one. As we can see, the 12-month limit is given for each pollutant, along with the space to record each month's emissions. Notice the units are in tons. Again, always be sure to report in the correct units. When setting up your 12-month total spreadsheet, the facility potential emissions calculations can be used to provide emission factors and other useful information. Applicable air quality information for most products can be found on the safety data sheet. However, if you need to, you can contact the manufacturing company for such information. Section E, control equipment requirements. Different types of control equipment include scrubbers, afterburners, thermal oxidizers, and more. Be sure to check this section for monitoring, record keeping, and reporting requirements. Section F is also very important. This one tells what the facility needs to record if and when testing is required. Please note that all records must be kept on site for 5 years. In addition, Section F gives the requirements associated with allowing members of the Energy and Environment Cabinet to complete inspections, request records, or sample or monitor substances or parameters to assure compliance with permit requirements. In essence, it says no one shall prohibit the cabinet from performing required duties within reasonable times. This slide provides the semi-annual monitoring report requirements. You must submit every 6 months, and it is due January 30th and July 30th. The SAMR requires evaluation and sworn certification signed by a responsible official to provide greater assurance and responsibility of a facility's compliance with air quality regulations. For the SAMR, there is not a standard format or form. The main thing that all submissions will need is a cover letter, which includes all of the important information that is provided on the cover page of your permit. These include the facility identifier's name, the AI number, the permit number, and the reporting period. In addition to the cover letter, you will add spreadsheets or tables to summarize your monitoring data. Please avoid using colors in your tables, since everything is scanned and therefore becomes grayscale. Part 7 and 8 of Section F of this permit example list the notifications and requirements for startup, shutdown, malfunctions, and emission exceedances. For notifications, you may contact your regional office or inspector, or preferably submit routine notifications electronically. Part 9 of Section F is for the annual compliance certification. Let's go through what is required for it. The ACC is a direct requirement of the Clean Air Act and is codified in Kentucky Administrative Regulations, so it is both a state and federal requirement. Any Kentucky Division of Air Quality permit holder is required to submit ACC and SAMRs. Facilities with a registration do not have to, and operational O permits prior to 1991 may not have to. The intent of the reporting requirements is for facilities to investigate their air emission sources, confirm proper monitoring and record keeping, and ensure the authorities with their compliance to air quality regulations and the conditions of the permit. In addition, the ACC requires sworn certification signed by a responsible official to provide greater assurance and responsibility of a facility's compliance with air quality regulations. While not recommended, minor modifications to the form are allowable, but significant changes must be pre-approved by your regional office. One modification that nearly everyone may have to make will be the addition or duplication of pages in order to accommodate the number of applicable permit conditions or requirements for the facility. Section G. While the general provision section is full of information, it is important to note that 6 months prior to the expiration date of your permit, a renewal must be submitted. Section H and I. Your permit may or may not have information listed here, depending on if your facility or operations are subject. The following are some additional modules that may be helpful to you. Please feel free to contact us with any questions you might have regarding your air permit. This concludes today's module. The Environmental Compliance Assistance Program hopes you have enjoyed this presentation, and we encourage you to reach out to us if any further assistance is needed, not only for your air permits, but for any other environmental issues you may need assistance with. Thank you. Have a great day.